All right, it's showtime, everyone. Now that we looked into all the metrics and all the things we need to keep in mind and all that, we can actually dive deeper into UX world and UX metrics and design KPIs and all of that stuff. And oh my, I'm so excited about that. Because this is kind of the place where magic happens, really. This is where we can actually not just learn a few new insights here and there, but we can actually identify and track success over time. We just need to really build it up first, right? So how do we do that? Well, great question. Well, one of the really great ways to actually move an organization that is maybe deeply invested and rooted and passionate about NPS is the way of maybe reframing this question a little. Like this question of how likely are you to recommend to a friend or colleague is, again, rooted in the future. And every time you have anything that's kind of all predictive or kind of looking in the future without any facts, without any research, without any insights, and especially if it's self-reported by users, they're just not reliable enough because it's predicting the future. We should be looking in the past instead. And feedback scoring is kind of this way of looking at a slightly different way, at a very similar sentiment, but also creating and giving designers us actionable feedback, which I love. So how does it work? Well, it's all about this notion of rephrasing NPS a little bit. And it's coming from this wonderful, wonderful case study that Anna Debenham has written a couple of years ago now, when she was writing about an alternative to NPS for the project that she was working on, which is all around the dev tools, developers tools. And the way that she twisted this notion of NPS, which is often, again, almost like a holy grail in many organizations, is to maybe twist the question a little bit. Slowly. So if you are using NPS, you can try to dial it a little bit, right? For example, you could say, well, if you were to move to different teams or company that wasn't using our product, how likely would you be to recommend its use? You can specify it even more, saying if you're, like, say, operating in a specific environment, maybe B2B or so, you can say, if you were to move to a different B2B team or company that's working on a B2B product that wasn't using us, would you be recommended? How likely are you to recommend it to us on a scale from, you know, 0 to 10, if you like to, if you really want to use NPS, right? That's more useful because it's more contextual. It kind of grounds this question, which is often very fluffy and non-specific, right? Recommend to whom, to what, when, why? But this is a bit more specific, right? And this is what I like a lot here because it kind of gets really relevant for two types of groups, right? On the one hand for product teams, and on the other hand for sales, right? Very helpful. But you can dial it a little bit more, where you can say, instead of even looking in the future, let's look at the past. In the last 6 weeks, have you referred or mentioned our product to a friend or colleague? Captures very specific action. It's either it happened or it did not happen. That's it. Now, sure, of course, some people will not truthfully answer that question, and that's expected, right? This is not, there is nothing we can do with it except for increasing sample size, right? But this is something that's, again, more actionable because it looks at, did you do it or did you not do it back in the last 6 weeks? Maybe it should be 6 months, maybe it should be a year, right? The problem is the longer you go, the less likely people to remember that they actually were or were not doing things. So you might want to be kind of limiting the time frame there. So still very relevant and probably a little bit more useful than NPS is, right? Or even further, if you have something like maybe, I don't know, onboarding, or somebody went through the entire process of buying a subscription or so, you can say, hey, as a new subscriber, were you referred to us by a friend or colleague? Yes or no? So it's, again, more relevant for everyone, more relevant for sales team, more also relevant in terms of capturing specific intent that somebody or action that somebody actually has performed. But we need to be very careful. We can, of course, keep twisting, keep dialing up and down. But at some point, it gets a little bit challenging because we should avoid all the things that we should be avoiding in good research. Like, for example, leading questions. This would not be a good question. Was your onboarding fast and on point? No, that doesn't work because it's leading. What we mean by that is that whenever you ask a question like that, most people are more likely to be agreeing with you rather than contradict you. So if you almost lead people to an answer, oh, it was fast and on point, right? Well, then yes, more people will be replying yes, but this is not necessarily accurate. So that's not something that we could use. In fact, when you look at NPS and how it has been evolving, and the reason I focus so much on it because it really has a very strong presence in every company organization I've been working with, you find that in some way, the questions around whether somebody has recommended a product or not in the past, like this question that we looked at in here, is actually present and it's actually a part of the conversation. For example, there is this notion of NPS3, the new version of NPS, which is now called Earned Advocacy Score, which augments NPS by asking two additional questions. Have you recommended a product to a friend or colleague, right? And also, have you discouraged someone from using a product, right? Which is kind of, again, rooted in the past. So actually, again, looking back at the past is really a safe bet, for sure. It's definitely better than looking in the future. It's calculated as percentage of recommended minus a percentage of discouraged, very similar to what we have with NPS as well. But that's just the preparation work. Because ultimately, what we can do with some of those statements that you saw previously, could pull them in and create sort of an interesting mechanism that really is way more actionable for designers than, let's say, just a simple NPS score is, right? And it works like this. We basically get a feedback scoring, we have a gap analysis. The feedback scoring is where we turn qualitative feedback that we get from users into data that we can quantify. And gap analysis helps us identify mismatch or anything that's kind of this the gaps between the user expectation and what we're actually providing in our product. And the way it works is really simple, really, really simple. First, we sit down and we discuss what things are important for us in our product. This is kind of like feedback statements that we give to survey users. For example, we could say, we want to figure out how good is our onboarding. Maybe we want to figure out if our filters are reasonable and useful enough. If they're well sorted and well organized. Maybe we want to figure out if search is working properly. What are some of the really critical pending questions that we need to think of? Kind of to figure out what we need to do next, right? We just sit down and we try to figure out what are the right feedback statements and what are kind of people that we want to send it to, right? And that second part is also important. We should not underestimate it. That's probably the first thing we want to figure out, because we can send a survey with up to 5 statements. I will talk about statements in just a second. And we ask people to just rank how much they agree or disagree with the statement on a scale from 1 to 5, right? It can also be 1 to 7, but 1 to 5 is perfectly fine as well. For example, one of the statements could be, the product is easy to ingrain into my existing workflows. All right, so if you want to figure that out and want to get some feedback, well, let's just send out a survey like that. Strongly disagree, strongly agree, and we get some responses from that, right? So that's kind of a statement that we can have. And we can have, of course, a few more than that. Then we go ahead and say, all right, so we need to figure out how we get to reasonable, accurate, and useful insights. So maybe we should segment it by the type and audiences and then plot the results. How do we do that? Well, let's start with the plotting the results first. First, once we get responses from our customers, we need to map how they responded for each of the statements. And the way it works is, with these response scores, is in a radial graph, like this. So you might have 5 statements, right? The product helps me understand my company's security posture. The tool is user-friendly. The tool is simple to ingrain into existing workflows. We saw it already. The support team is responsive and helpful. It supports the languages and integrations I care about. Right, again, on the scale from 1, right, being pretty much not very helpful, right, 5, doing all the job all the way, very satisfied with that, right? And so you go through this and you basically track this over time. So you set your goals where you want to be. We'll talk about that later, by the way, as well. When we think about like the setting the goals and the targets that we want to achieve, where do we want to be, kind of setting the goals, and we track them over time by setting that survey repeatedly to the same segment of audience, maybe not necessarily to the same people, but to the same segment of audience to get that notion of whether we're improving or not. And the way it would work is, we just set goals where we want to be, right? We maybe know where we are right now. That's always an important part. We need to understand how we're doing right now. So usually you would have sort of a baseline survey or foundational survey that you would need to run to just see how you're doing across those statements. And then you set a time period. And then you get new responses and you track if you are improving over time. This could look something like this, right? This is maybe where you are now. And this is where you want to be. And so you work throughout your interface here and there, trying to improve your stature, your position, your stature, I guess is the word, right, towards all of these different dimensions. And, you know, remember, when we're looking into things like that, we can actually think about those five statements being like five North Star metrics for a team that is working on those things, right? And this is a tool that they could be using to see if they're making progress in the right direction or not. It's not like a score, which is just a number, but you get the sort of sentiment from people how well they are responding to particular statements and how agree they are to these statements. And of course, you can break it down across different personas that you might have. You might say, well, let's take a look at different team sizes. Let's take a look at free customers and paid customers. Let's take a look at new users and people who experienced already in our tool. Let's take a look at people who are on different plans, like a starter plan, a pro plan, an enterprise plan. And they might have different feedback statements to agree or disagree with, right? That's then up to you to decide what you're going to work on. But every team might have a bunch of statements like that, which you can send to customers to get a lot of feedback, well, hopefully, because in the end, this is quantitative data testing, right? Kind of rely on the fact that a lot of people will respond to kind of see how you're doing, how you're performing. And of course, in the end, you can also integrate it and gather information with Intercom and HubSpot and all these other different tools, right? Which is also kind of an option there. And also, Anna has nicely, neatly put together kind of a bunch of example statements that we can just go ahead and use as inspiration. So that's available right there. For example, it could be the support team is helpful, is responsive. The company positively supports the open source community. But these statements must be coming from a workshop with you and your stakeholders and your colleagues. That's kind of significant there. It can also happen on many different levels, right? Because we could be looking at customer support. It might be very important for us. We can also look at the performance, how we're doing. Is it perceived as fast and snappy? We can also look at clarity. Do people understand what we display on the product page? It can also look into filters. Do people understand how we group filters and stuff like that, right? So that's not qualitative testing. And you know, people who know me know that I love qualitative testing, to sit down with the person and see what they're doing, right? But this is still very helpful to get some relatively quick feedback at scale, right? Which is, again, something you cannot do with qualitative testing. So with this in mind, what you actually do get as a result of that is basically a customized set of statements that you and your team are discussing in order to get to this notion of how are we performing now, right? And then it's really almost like an internal tool for your design team, where you can say, all right, well, let's see if we have improved here. Let's think about this feature. This is where we want to be, and this is where we are right now. What is actually missing? And in that gap, this is where we're going to identify, try to identify what is missing there, doing research and trying to identify these problems that people are experiencing, speaking to those people and see if, you know, if we can uncover those user needs. And then we can run this survey again. Right, repeatedly, maybe every 3, 2, 4, 5, 6 weeks, whatever your velocity of the team is, right, to see if we're tracking in the trending in the right direction. So a very helpful tool that is often kind of maybe forgotten or overlooked, but could be a very nice replacement to slowly move towards this notion of UX metrics. But of course, there is way more, and we have to dive into all those different types of service and types of testing that we can conduct to actually measure and assess UX. And that's the heart of everything. This is the heart of this course, and hopefully the heart of things that you're going to implement later when you actually start measuring UX in small or in large company. So let's dive right in. Let's go all the way in into UX metrics.